Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Ethical Human Society. My name is Bobby Jacob, and I will be moderating today's program, Lasting Effects of COVID-19 on the Healthcare System and Policy, presented by Katie Merrell. Today's platform is virtual. As you can see, out of concern for everyone, the EHS has discontinued in-person gatherings. When the time is right, in-person gatherings will return. The chat box will be closed for comments during the formal presentation, but after the presentation concludes, it will be opened up for question submission for the Q&A portion. I'll start out today's program with a quote that helps define what humanism means to us as members of the Ethical Humanist Society. Although humanists have either an agnostic or atheistic point of view, it does not follow that all agnostics and atheists could be described as humanists. Agnosticism or atheism is a relatively unimportant part of humanist religion and philosophy. Many humanists dislike the labels of atheism and agnosticism on account of their possible negative implications. What they do not believe in counts relatively little for them. It is what they do believe in and how and why they believe this that makes them humanists. That is Lloyd Moraine, past president of the American Humanist Association. At the EHS, our programs address a wide variety of topics, including current events, philosophy, arts and sciences, to name just a few. Today's presentation is part of our ongoing programming related to healthcare. Today's speaker is Katie Merrell. Katie Merrell, Senior Research Analyst at Actuarial Research Corp, will look beyond the current pandemic to consider the different ways that COVID-19 might affect the way that healthcare is provided and paid for in its aftermath. The current pandemic continues to present real-time challenges to policymakers and healthcare providers to reduce the morbidity and mortality of COVID-19. At the same time, they are starting to contemplate what a post-COVID-19 healthcare system might look like. This talk will examine some of the factors that are likely to shape that post-COVID-19 system. Katie is a nationally recognized expert on Medicare payment policy and the use of administrative data to develop and improve policy. In March, she was part of a team that was tasked with providing data analyses to the White House's coronavirus task force, and has since been in conversations with researchers and policymakers about the policy and system changes that may occur in the coming months and years. Please welcome Katie Merrell.
Hi. Thanks so much, Bobby, and I'm glad to be here with you guys today, and I'm glad to go straight to my slides. There we go. And as Bobby said, I'm going to talk about the long-term effects of COVID on policy and the healthcare system. So hang on a minute. I have to change my own thing. There we go. I want to start, which is not my normal way to start. I usually start explaining what we're going to talk about, and I'm not. I'm going to kind of talk about what I'm not talking about. I'm not going to talk about the current issues related to masks, distancing, school, public transit, going to work. I'm not talking about any of that kind of stuff. I think there's a ton of different issues there. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of why that matters, but I'm not going to address any of those topical things. So if that's what you're interested in, you can hang up and go do something else. My expertise is in payment policy and the Medicare program particularly, but more broadly as well. And it's not, as you'll see, in public health or clinical care. If you are a public health or clinical care expert, please just don't judge too harshly as I touch on little issues in those areas. But I do come at it from a policy perspective. I also feel like it's really important to say in this context that policy talks and the kind of work I do can seem really unconcerned with the underlying human toll that they're addressing. And I just want to just say, before I fall into the world of data and costs and long-term planning, I want to say that this is a really bad disease and people are dying and people are very sick. And even when they recover, they remain compromised in many ways. So I know that and I care about that. And from the rest of my talk, I'm going to sound like I don't know or care. And I don't like that, but that's the reality of the kind of work I do. And so I just want to say that. And the last thing I want to talk about that I'm not talking about is the fact that there's some other really major factors going on in our society right now, which are very likely to affect the future of the healthcare system. Most importantly among them, the movement for Black Lives and the upcoming elections, not only the presidential election, but all the state and local and other federal offices. All of those things are going to have a huge effect, I think, on the healthcare system moving forward. So I'm not going to talk about those things. I'm just going to talk about the very narrow little slice about the effect of what we've all been going through and how that might inform policymaking in the healthcare field moving forward. So that's what I'm doing. And I'm going to start. I want to start with a very oversimple picture. I think this is a very common kind of intuitive way that people think about this whole corner of the world. And we have this notion there's germs, and not all diseases are due to germs. So they're in quotes here, but it's the thing that makes people sick, whatever it is, whatever the insult is. And I'm calling them germs. And so we have something that is bad for human bodies, and they perturb well-being and they cause illness. So that's the second little bubble. And we identify the germ causing an illness, people are unwell, and we want to remedy that. So we create something that we call medical care to remedy the illness and restore well-being. And those things can collectively create, I think intuitively people think of it that way, is a system in which that medical care is provided and policies that that sort of shape the way that that is happening, whether it's who can provide the care, who gets paid for the care, the terms under which the care can be received, all of the different things. Those are sort of policy level issues. And I think people kind of have this little tiny little things up to bigger things kind of map in their head. And I think I'm going to layer onto that map the notion of the people who populate those spaces. So on the germ side, I have biologists and virologists and bench scientists of all sorts of manner. I don't even know who all those guys are, but there's a bunch of guys who do things I don't know much about, but that I benefit from. And then those guys identify the things that cause human illness, and the people who understand how the germs make human bodies unwell are people we think of as medical researchers, drug developers. Again, a lot more than that. Those are suggestive. And once we understand the illness and want to remedy it somehow, we turn into the medical care world. And that's where I think most people enter the space. And we know about nurses and physicians and therapists and pharmacists and a million other guys that live in that bubble. And at the end of that food chain is people like me and administrators. And by administrators, I mean both hospital administrators, like people who run healthcare facilities, and people who run healthcare programs, whether it's the City of Chicago Public Health Department, or whether it's the state, or whether it's federal government. So there's a lot of people who are administrators of different types that help make the system work or not work. There's professional societies. My joke in the world I'm in, which is physician payment, my joke is if there's a body part, there's a society about it. It's not literally true, but it's kind of close. And then there's a million other professional societies, and those are of consequence both with the transmission of information and the lobbying of lawmakers to inform policy. There's policy analysts, like people like me and people really different from me, but that we all are called policy analysts. And there's elected officials. And obviously we're all mindful that they, at the end of the day, have a huge impact on all those moving parts. So that's kind of who populates the little simple food chain. But I also want to say, I think the food chain, that intuitive sense, is kind of misleading, because when I'm over in the right and I'm thinking about the healthcare system and healthcare policy, I'm immediately talking of and thinking about a lot of things that actually affect the earlier steps in that simple little chain. So I'm thinking about the kind of services that are covered and paid for by insurance, by Medicare, by Medicaid, by block grant programs in maternal child health, all those things. And the availability of money affects what medical care is developed and is available to people. Drug development, as you guys are familiar, and we'll come back to in a minute, there's a million rules. Well, okay, not a million, but there's a lot of rules that affect the development of drugs and making them available to people once they're proved to be safe and effective. There's a lot of policy around training and licensure. With regard to all the people in the medical care box, there's state variation. And in some states, advanced practice nurses can basically do a lot of what doctors do. And in other states, there's a lot of limitations on what advanced practice nurses can do. And those things affect the way this whole thing plays out for individuals. There's the care infrastructure itself. And a lot of cities have very extensive and very mature and public health programs that are run and administered by the city, and some places don't have things like that, in addition to all the private hospitals and other entities that are important to providing care. And then there's the whole research industry, which is, it includes people in every one of these boxes. And it's the biologists over there on the left, and then it's the medical researchers in the second box, and it's the some of the clinical researchers in the third box, and it's the people in my box with me. And so what research is done, what research is funded, what research gets disseminated, all of that stuff is affected by the system and by policy. So it's not a simple line that goes from the teeny tiny little original insult up into the policy that affects how we get paid for. It's those policies at the end shape the information and the kinds of things that get considered along the food chain. So that might've been really obvious to everybody, and I'm sorry, but sometimes people, I think, don't think of it that way. So it's not a simple thing, and it's all what I say endogenous to itself. So the policy informs what we end up learning about. And I think that's really important to keep in mind. And that's why the kinds of things I'm going to talk about today are so important, because I'm already been in conversations of anticipating how the policies of the next months and years will affect what the healthcare system looks like, given this big insult that the system itself has had through COVID. So that's kind of the background and context I wanted to sort of have us all share. And now I'm going to start in a very, well, possibly very predictable place, but I didn't predict it until I did it, which is I'm going to start with Larry Kramer. And those of you who are sort of my age or older will recognize him as a renowned writer and AIDS activist. And he became sort of the front of advocacy for improving access to novel treatments for AIDS patients during the AIDS epidemic. And I saw this come by in my Twitter feed a few days ago, and it felt like a really important thing to point out, which is Anthony Fauci, who we hear about a lot now. He came of age in the AIDS epidemic and got the stature he has came up through that time. And he has this quote here: "There's no question in my mind that Larry helped change medicine in this country, and he helped change it for the better." And there, he wasn't in my picture. I didn't have activist anywhere in my little bubbles. I think it's really important to know that what happened in the AIDS epidemic really had a huge effect on some of the machinery that had been in place before, particularly with regard to novel drug treatments for terminal illness. And the AIDS patients said, "I'm dying anyway. Go ahead and test it on me because it can't make me worse." So that really changed the pipeline for drug development and testing. It really got changed because of the work of somebody like Larry Kramer and lots of other people, but he became the face of it. And I want to juxtapose that, which I think was very innovative and probably saved lives, with this thing I just saw the other day. And the New Yorker turns out to be the go-to place, apparently. I didn't know that, but here I am learning so much from them. Just the other day, I saw this one. The long game on coronavirus research. Warp speed vaccine trials grab our attention, but more deliberate work is just as urgent. And this article just kind of makes that what you can tell from that, that yes, what Larry Kramer had us do for AIDS patients was important, and it did probably save lives. And at the same time, the sort of plotting due diligence kind of research of people like Anthony Fauci probably really has big value for how we eventually can understand and can confirm our understanding of some novel thing like this. So that I put this here to just acknowledge this kind of crazy dichotomy of we've got to fix this now because people are really sick and people are dying, versus you can't make knowledge happen faster. And if this particular infectious agent takes months and months and months to reveal everything about itself, we're just going to have to wait months and months and months and months to learn all that stuff. And you can't side pass some of the rituals of research and replicability of research and that peer review process and things like that. So again, I'm providing this as a context for the space that we're in right now and that will inform how we move forward. So with that, I want to jump into spring 2020 and COVID-19. becomes the thing that we're thinking about in the healthcare system. And the problem is that there's incredible uncertainty about the disease process itself. There's incredible uncertainty about the effective care process, and the president weighed in on that, and it turned out it wasn't a helpful thought. But lots of people have opinions about the effective care process. And I talk to physicians who talk about just in their own emergency department or wherever context they're working, how they are changing week to week what they're trying to do. Like, this seemed to work pretty well on the last 10 patients. So we're going to try it again on the next guy, and then it doesn't work well. So there's just been a lot of sort of real time trying to learn what an effective care process is for patients presenting with this disease. And they're presenting with very different symptoms and severity, which is also very challenging. And there's a real uncertainty of the resource needs because we don't know what they need. So we've been hearing a lot about respirators. And then we hear that by the time you're on a respirator, your odds of survival are very low. So the real emphasis is let's get the care sorted out before you get to respirators. And so it goes. So you guys have been seeing all of those headlines too. You might not look at them, but I noticed them. And so who we should be supporting and who, what doctors, what healthcare facilities, what non-doctor providers really need extra support is just not been clear. So there's been a lot of uncertainty, as you can see. It's three times on this slide, so much uncertainty. And the result of three dimensions of uncertainty, if not more, is a huge policy challenge. Because it is such a big deal and it is so important, and yet we don't know much about it. So the response in the United States was this, what was declared a public health emergency in March. And there's this, it was the result of, despite all that uncertainty and we're not sure what we need to be doing, we have to do something, which I get. It's back to Larry Kramer. I get it. And so what happened was things like some targeted emergency funding based on the information that was coming up and communities that were hard hit. So we heard about New York City, we heard about the Pacific Northwest, and there was specific focus on trying to support those communities in the early days. And as you guys know, it's kind of blossomed out from there. I think nationwide, there was a very strong movement to stop all elective care to maintain capacity for COVID patients. And in some places where there was never much of a burden, that just was really hard on local medical economies. And in places where those beds were needed, it turned out to work out really well. So that was a common response. There's a lot of things I don't know much about, but that are important, which is raving regulatory burdens for treatment innovation and for vaccine innovation. Again, a la Larry Kramer. And again, the uncertainty about what's important makes the regulatory burden waiving thing very uncertain. And the risk obviously is if you kind of go too far and you let people cut corners in ways that are important or protective to well-being, then it can become counterproductive. So it's a balancing act. And then two concrete things, and Bobby mentioned that I did some work in March for the White House task force. Anticipate the problem. So at the time, all we knew was elderly were particular risk. We also know that long-term care facilities are by definition very vulnerable populations by age, just because that's the thing we knew. And so the one of the things the task force asked itself, and I spent a couple of days helping work on, was given the data that are available through the Medicare program about long-term care facility quality and infection control and stuff like that, can we anticipate what facilities, specific facilities might be at particular risk? And really try to use that as like where triaging and testing needed to be focused. And so I just scrambled around and did some stuff like that. It felt kind of exciting. I don't know how useful it actually was, but that's the kind of work that was going on. And then there was this, the last thing that was a very salient in my corner of the world was the changing the coverage for certain services. In the Medicare program, telehealth and telemedicine services have historically been covered in the spirit of making expert, geographically remote experts available to people in rural areas. So the model has been that Medicare has covered those services. If you're sitting in an outpatient clinic in a rural place, and you and your provider collectively do a remote visit with special technology with the fancy researcher at the state research hospital that's 322 miles away or something like that. So that's how Medicare has covered telehealth and telemedicine for the most part until March. And then the issue came up that everyone's being told, no, don't go home. I mean, don't go to the doctor, stay home. Don't go to the doctor. And people need to talk to the doctors. So Medicare made the policy decision that they were just going to cover a regular office visit through over the telephone with your doctor and pay the doctor as much as they pay for the same visit as if you had gone into her office. And so that's a huge decision because that's the most common service Medicare pays for. It's a ton of money. It could be a really smart decision, right? Keeping elderly people from going to healthcare centers. But it was a very consequential financially and possibly consequential with regard to making care available to people if they knew and took advantage of that option. So that's kind of the, you know, the different kind of balls that are in there. It's a lot of different agencies. It's a lot of different local leaders and federal leaders running around trying to figure out how do we have to unstick resources or rules to make possible improvements for people. And you get to this, my pet peeve as a policy guy is this phrase, unintended consequences. I used to teach policy analysis at the University of Chicago. And to me, I told my students all the time, unintended consequences is really oopsie for policy analysts. And I think the right word is unanticipated outcomes. And sometimes they're really surprising and it's not that surprising you didn't anticipate. A lot of times when I see unintended consequences, it's things I did anticipate. And it makes me mad because it makes it sound like oopsie and no one should be held accountable. So in the spirit of, I think that what we've been through for the last many months is a chance for lots of unintended consequences. And I highlight one here, something that came through my little Twitter world the other day. Maybe it's not the intent of this law, unrelated, the law doesn't matter, but telling us now after the fact that, quote, actually you may get sued for canceling that elective surgery because you were told to, end quote, is truly a slap on the face to doctors all around. Healthcare heroes, ? Just another win for trial lawyers. And this is just kind of addressing the kinds of turmoil and possible fallout of all of this quick activity and possibly unanticipatable outcomes. But I think the idea that 2 and 3 months ago, doctors were told don't do elective surgeries and that's the rule. And now they have an impression that they may be liable for having canceled those surgeries if the patient subsequently has bad health outcomes that would have been prevented by that. That's a really tricky, hard problem that it undermines people's faith in the system, and it highlights kind of the potential dislocations when all the different gears are spinning fast. So now I've talked about the COVID-19 for like 20 minutes, even though I told you I wasn't gonna. So basically you've learned I'm a liar. But now I really am gonna turn to what I told you I was gonna talk about. But I felt like that was helpful to set it up. What I wanna talk about is the healthcare system and policy after COVID-19. And I put quotes on after because this is a new thing that's gonna be with us probably indefinitely. And by after here, I mean this current crisis situation. And whatever our new normal is, there's going to be a lot. I personally think that there's going to be a lot of different kinds of things that will be different in the healthcare system and will be challenging to healthcare policy makers. So I'm going to go through in my very simplistic way. I think it's helpful to think about the demand for healthcare and the supply of healthcare. And on the demand side, I'm going to touch on changes in population mortality and morbidity. And the effect on patients themselves, just on their view of the healthcare system and engagement with it. On the supply side, I'm going to talk about changes in content of care and the way it's organized. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about effect on providers themselves. And then I'll just wrap up on the policy take. So that's where we're going now. This is usually my first slide. So on the demand side, mortality and morbidity. Morbidity is a fancy word for like sickness, illness in a population. So this is like death and illness. and there's direct COVID effects on mortality and morbidity when you think about the population as a whole. And so I'm going to just touch on a few. And again, if you're public health people or clinical people, you probably have a better and more comprehensive list. This is kind of what I've come up with for today. First, the direct COVID-19 effect is premature death. And the theory is that most of the people who died from COVID in the last few months weren't going to die in the last few months. They might have been old and frail, but they weren't necessarily terminal. Some of the people who died in the last few months were probably going to die in the last few months. And so those aren't considered premature death. Certainly the younger adults who are dying and teenagers and stuff, those are definitely would be considered premature death. So the question that comes to my mind immediately, having lived around epidemiologists for a while, is just immediately thinking about the idea that there will be less death from other causes. If the older and frailer population who have died in the last few months, that weren't necessarily going to die in the last few months, but were likely to die, say, in the next year or two, what that kind of should suggest to us that we should expect less death in the next year or two, because a lot of those guys died in the last few months. And then a quick example that comes to mind is the flu mortality for this next flu cycle of flu season. I can imagine it's going to look pretty different, right? Because a lot of the people who might have naturally been very vulnerable to dying of the flu next winter have already died because of this last few months. So there's this notion of less death from other causes. So you might see pictures where there's a spike in deaths and then kind of a lull. And then over a couple of years, it'll kind of flatten back out to some normal rate. So the other side of that for the healthcare system is there's less health needs for those frail patients. And that's when it sounds hard-hearted, and I'm not a hard-hearted person, but, the reality is that those patients who weren't going to die in the last few months, but did, are now not consuming healthcare services. And that just affects possibly some of the machinery in the healthcare system. And it's not a celebration, but just a reality. The other really important direct effect of this disease in the mortality and morbidity concepts is the unknown long-term effects of this on human bodies. And we just don't know. And so the things I read, again, I'm not a clinician and I can't begin to understand what's important about what I'm reading. But I do see the things that go on about multi-organ effects compromised in survivors. And I think that's going to create new clinical challenges for caregivers where we see uncommon combinations of long-term compromised health that haven't necessarily been in concert together. And the survivors themselves now have new health burdens, at least some. And again, this is evolving and some of those may resolve in ways that we don't understand. But there's likely to be new health burden among survivors. And from a clinical perspective, that's a new burden on the healthcare system. From a personal perspective, that's now a pre-existing condition. So this may create some effects on the health insurance conversation that we're having nationally. And whether it's Obamacare or single payer or whatever, there's maybe going to be a new crop of patients who have more skin in the game, so to speak, and their families who are concerned. So there's kind of been just a sort of a shock to the system of people with now possibly pre-existing conditions. That is not yet known how that'll play out. But this is the kind of different ideas that I kind of go through my head when I read headlines. The secondary effects may be empirically much more important than those primary effects. And the first one that is front of mind in kind of throughout the healthcare system is the effect of foregone care. And it's the potential increase in both mortality and morbidity for non-COVID-19 causes. I've listed a few I'm going to call out here just to kind of get your brain going, but there's a billion more. Well, okay, not a billion, but a lot. And I think it's really, really important always to think about what didn't happen when we're so focused on what is happening. So things that didn't happen is primary care visits. Again, there were those new telehealth visits provided for Medicare. I think a lot of insurers did similar policies, but whether patients understood that or how to use them or what was useful about them may be really different. So, you know, blood pressure, guys with hypertension and on medication for it, and they go on annually and have that managed and they get their drugs recalibrated. Those visits didn't happen probably. And I don't know if that'll matter, right? But possibly there's more unmanaged hypertension now, undiagnosed and unmanaged hypertension for the lack of primary care visits for the last many months. The emergency rooms, the emergency departments, ED, I'm sorry I did that. We've heard a lot about them. We know they've been swamped. And what has happened, and again, you guys probably saw the same headlines I did, there's a lot of people who did not go to the emergency room who probably should have, who were having some kind of a health crisis unrelated to COVID. And they were either afraid of going because they thought they would get COVID if they went, or they really thought they weren't supposed to, even if they needed to. And so there's stories of spikes in fatal heart attacks and strokes, unmanaged strokes and things like that, because the messaging about don't go to the emergency room was heard without much nuance. And so the effect of that is gonna play out somehow, I don't know. Opioid abuse, I put that here because a year ago I spent a lot of time working with folks at the Medicare agency on different efforts they're making, required by law and for other reasons, to putting more money, Medicare money, as other agencies have done, into opioid, helping deal with the opioid epidemic. And it was been a huge deal. It's again costing lots of lives and making lots of lives really hard. And there was a very concerted effort last year to figure out how to loosen requirements and make certain kind of drug education stuff payable by Medicare that has historically not been payable, things like that. And as you can imagine, a lot of that work was put on hold in the spring. And so a secondary effect of COVID will now be, well, I've already seen headlines over the last couple of weeks, new spikes in the opioid abuse challenges that many communities are facing, because those resources haven't been deployed. And healthcare providers haven't been available to keep on that problem. So that's the kind of thing that's just kind of reemerged while we were looking at somewhere else. Another kind of example of the kind of care that's been foregone and is likely to affect our healthcare system moving forward is cancer screening and treatment. So somebody who might have had a mammogram in March and been detected with stage one breast cancer maybe foregoes that care for a long time because she's now scared of going and has broken her habit of when she goes. And by the time she finally gets a mammogram later this year, early next year, she's now diagnosed with stage two cancer or whatever. I don't know how much that will happen, but I think that's the kind of stuff we're gonna start seeing researchers talk about. And you can imagine that the effect on the healthcare system of this sort of distribution of cancer patients, like where they are in their care and the severity of their cancer, has big effects on their care processes and their healthcare service needs. And at the same time, there were people who were undergoing cancer treatment in the and other diseases in the spring and summer. And some of that has continued in some places, and some of that was curtailed. And even in places where the caregivers tried to continue it, patients were afraid to go. So again, I think we're going to learn a lot about the importance of the scheduling of a lot of care that didn't get done. And we're going to come back to that later. And then the final one that just is just really hard to wrap your head around is pediatric vaccination. And there's a lot of different stories. Again, I think it's been regional how this has played out. But as you all are probably familiar, there has been over the last many years this anti-vaccine enthusiasm, and based on a long retracted article that has really undermined vaccination habits in a lot of communities. And this is just further set back. That so a lot of people in that corner of the world are concerned that not only are we going to have to figure out how to educate people to get COVID-19 vaccination, and there's going to be people who are reluctant to do it, but we have a ton of catching up to do on what have been standard vaccinations. And I think some people in this area are worried that we're going to have measles outbreaks or whatever if the herd rates of the herd immunity gets too low in specific communities. So that's like a whole new worry that is kind of been magnified by the COVID-19 effect on the care system. Again, that is nowhere near an exhaustive list. And for clinicians who are listening, I'm sorry if I left yours out. I'm sure there's a story like this in almost every clinical area. I know psychiatric care and mental health services and others are facing similar challenges. But the other kind of interesting, that's sort of all sad and hard, but sort of a teeny tiny sort of silver lining to this cloud is changes in behavior with regard to infection transmission broadly. And some people are speculating about whether this crash course we've all had in infectious disease transmission and washing our hands and all those good things, if that might in fact help more broadly in reducing other infectious diseases. So just more broadly, next winter, are there going to be fewer colds and fewer less work lost to flu and stuff like that? And obviously that's a complete unknown, but if you're thinking about the healthcare system and policies to improve it, it's just kind of an interesting question about whether there may just be a secular change in human behavior or American behavior with regard to not shaking hands. Like that's the one we see a lot about. If we just stop shaking hands, will we all of a sudden have less infectious disease? I don't know. But those are the kinds of behaviors that could have actually a big effect on the kinds of care that our system needs to provide to people. The other side on the demand thing, the other sort of dimension I want to touch on real quickly on the demand side is patients themselves. And there's a lot of concern about increased anxiety about being indoors with strangers in general. A lot of people don't want to go to a restaurant. I'm one of them right now. I have no need to go to a restaurant, but eventually I'm assuming I will. But then there's even once you're over that and once you've gone to a restaurant a few times and you're feeling okay about it, you may have a particular anxiety about going to a healthcare space because I think we've kind of viewed them as kind of just this teeming with infection and people go there and die. And it's been really a lot. It's sort of traumatic in some communities. So even when physicians are ready to provide care and services are available, they're on the margin, there's concern that some patients will be very reluctant to seek care. And that's going to be a new kind of challenge to the system to think about. I think similar but a little different is lost confidence in healthcare information and the system. We've had just sort of chaotic messaging, I'd say since January, from federal, state, and local leaders. Some of it's been very consistent science-based, and some states have been doing a pretty interesting, really good job of listening to science. But the science itself has been evolving. And I don't know if you remember, I had a lot of uncertainty a few slides ago, and it really matters, right? So even a governor or a mayor who was trying to be super science-based over time has had to pivot on some policy decisions. And people who aren't understanding how science works and how novel this is just kind of go, these guys are idiots and they don't know what they're talking about. I don't need to do X. And I think that that leads to my last point here, which is there's people will draw personal conclusions in the face of all the uncertainty. So back to all that interrupted care. I didn't get my mammogram and I'm fine. So maybe I don't even need one next year. Or none of my friends got their mammograms and none of them have cancer. So I don't even know if we should be doing mammograms or whatever. So people are going to just kind of extrapolate from their teeny little corners of the world in this face of uncertainty and possibly unreliable experts to decide for themselves and possibly reinterpret their own understanding of what good care for themselves would look like. And I think that will be a very hard thing to overcome. And I don't know who takes that on. But I think that the confidence in experts, the confidence in science, the understanding of research, and how to act in the face of uncertainty are really important features of our healthcare system that we've maybe taken for granted and maybe have lost a little bit of, which I feel like is going to be a big challenge. I'm going to go from demand to supply now. On the supply side, again, I'm going to do two pieces, the care content and organization, and then I'm going to go to the providers. So on the care content and organizations, yeah, I've emphasized this, we suspended care in 2020, and that's like the hugest natural experiment ever in like the healthcare system, like what care matters, right? And so we don't know how important is the timing of mammograms or blood pressure consults before you recalibrate your hypertension medicine or whatever heck thing. We don't know. We have norms and they're based on sometimes good information, sometimes not. And now we've had this huge experiment, right? And so in the short run, I think providers are going to develop, just like patients. A minute ago, I told you patients are going to decide they don't need to do stuff because it didn't matter. They didn't do it last spring. I think providers will develop ad hoc conclusions based on their own patients and anecdote that they hear. So maybe they'll all decide that they can adjust screening schedules or follow-up schedules based on this natural experiment that hasn't been well studied, but they see what happened in front of them. And so they may overreact or underreact, basically, if that's a thing, to the experience of their particular panel of patients or the population around them and their colleagues. So that really puts a really big spotlight on research. And my own kind of sense is that we're going to face a big challenge in thinking about how to resurrect is maybe the wrong word, but re-engage existing research that's been perturbed for data reasons, for patient access reasons, all sorts of things, and think a little bit about, do we need to be doing other research? So should those guys, I don't know if you remember a few slides ago, I had people in those little middle bubbles, the clinical researchers and the medical researchers, should they just try to figure out how to pick up what they were doing 6 months ago and kind of recalibrate their work and their math and do the best they can? Or do some of them need to say, you know, this is maybe not the next most best use of my time, and I now need to pick up a different study. Like, I now see this natural experiment that's happened, and the way to inform my little field might be to just reconsider using this natural experiment in a different way. So I think that's a big conversation I have no idea how NIH might visit that with its grantees. And that will be different in different kinds of research. And there's heartbreaking stories. Again, you guys maybe see these too, but some of the bench scientists who like couldn't go like do change cultures because they had to get out of their buildings and stuff. So there's just a lot of work lost. And I think there's going to have to be some thought about how that gets restarted or whether it pivots to other work. I think on the care content, on a very practical level, there's likely to be a lot of new infection control requirements throughout the clinical care processes. I've been in conversations and I'm part of a research team that's been scouring specialty society pages and looking for specific guidance about how, you know, dermatologists should think about reopening their offices and, you know, cleaning their equipment and staging patients and stuff like that. And so there's going to be just a practical new burden, I think, on just care providers. Dentists, I don't know how many, the dentists have done a ton and have really doubled down on procedures for PPE, for their personal protective equipment for their staff and for the dentists and patients as appropriate. So there's just going to be a lot of new stuff that is built into care processes because of this new concern about infection control. We're always fighting the last war, right? So this will be, I think, even if this is well understood and well contained, I suspect there's going to be a strong movement towards this. New education burden, patient confusion about vaccination and other care protocols. I've already kind of touched on that. But again, I think providers are going to end up having to spend a lot of time regaining patients' trust and re-educating them to old norms or new norms and getting them to kind of conform. I think this is actually this next bullet that is kind of where I've been spending these next two is where I spend most of my time. The effect of ad hoc coverage and payment policy changes during COVID on the steady state post-period care. So for example, I mentioned telehealth. Medicare made these huge decisions in March about letting providers bill as much for a phone call with their Medicare patient as they used to get paid for an inpatient visit, for an in-person visit, sorry. And that made sense. And that was a very possibly very prudent thing. Moving forward, it's going to be really hard, to the extent that that's popular for patients and providers, it's going to be really hard to turn that off. And maybe it shouldn't be, I don't know. But there's going to be there's a lot of work going on already to think about whether and how to claw back some of the kind of ad hoc things that got done in March and April because we had to do something, versus the implications of keeping that moving forward as the new way it all works. And it has huge implications. It has, at a minimum, huge budgetary implications. I don't know yet if we have much information about the effect on quality of care and on patients' well-being. But that's the kind of stuff you'd want to know before you actually made a big decision about that. The other kind of thing that's been very compromised reasonably by the ad hoc decisions of the last few months, and it's not at all clear how they get reinstated, is the use of data for quality and resource management. So you may or may not have been aware, Medicare and other payers have put a lot of time and energy into creating what are called alternative payment models to move away from fee-for-service medicine. And a lot of those models, which is a whole nother talk, no one probably wants it, but if you do, I can try. Those models build in a lot of quality measures. So I mentioned diabetes, and you know, it's good quality care to have a particular blood test for diabetic for patients with diabetes at with a certain periodicity just to manage and help them manage their disease well and stay healthy. And so there's a lot of things built in to doctors proving they do that. They have to prove that of their patients with diabetes, this percentage of them had that particular blood test in the last quarter or something like that. And if they can prove that, then they get these quality payments. And obviously that isn't a fair or sensible thing given that doctors were told to not do stuff. So there's a lot of perturbation in care in payment models that embed care information like quality and how resources are used. And I think this big interruption of that, a lot of those rules were suspended for the purposes of this ongoing public health emergency. But as soon as the emergencies end, I'm not very confident that everybody's going to agree that all those rules just jump back into place, because there's going to be a lot of questions about, did it really change things? And are patients really worse off for not having done that and things like that? So I think there's just going to be a revisiting of a lot of existing policies, and in a very small way, but not unimportant because it's what I spend most of my time doing. Is the effect of perturbed 2020 care on ongoing payment processes. And the example I mentioned here is rate setting. So I work on Medicare physician payment, and every year there's a mechanism whereby next year's payment rates are established in an effort to not spend extra not to spend more money given the way that care was paid for this year and the volume of services. And volume is really important to figuring out the budget. And so the fact that we didn't do a lot of healthcare in March, April, May, June, we've been looking at claims data, and the 50% decline in the volume of care in for Medicare patients is going to make it really hard to do a lot of the math that happens every year to set next year's rates and the rates for the year after. And again, this is playing out not just in Medicare, but for insurers and everything. Those data about how people use care really drives planning and payment policy for the next time horizon. And those data are screwed up. And so the question that I've spent time talking to a lot of different kinds of analysts inside and outside of government is, how do we think about what volume would have been or should have been this year versus, for the reasons I've already talked about, could we imagine that there's a permanent shift in the number and mix of services that beneficiaries use in the Medicare program? So it's really going to be a challenging year or two, and I suspect lead to a lot of political fighting to sort that out. I'm almost done. I got two more slides, Bobby. I'm seeing the clock. I'm doing my best. On the supply side, I also want to talk about providers real quickly. And the direct effect on the supply is that a lot of healthcare providers die, not a lot in the sense of thousands, but a lot of the premature deaths were among healthcare providers of all different types. And the survivors, a lot of healthcare providers were sick, and they are some of the people carrying those longer term health consequences that we still don't understand. So there's increased morbidity among healthcare providers. And importantly, there's burnout. I have a friend who's an emergency room doctor at Northwestern, and his wife's just been really worried about him. And he's about 60, and he may or may not be an emergency room doctor in a year. I don't know. And I think that story's playing out across the country. So I think that there's just this cohort of doctors and respiratory therapists and critical care nurses have just been through a lot. And I'm not sure that they'll have the normal sort of professional career that everyone would have expected. So that may create sort of new shortages quickly for certain types of caregivers. We may see a change in needs, provider needs, given the change in patient mortality and morbidity that I talked about earlier. So if patients, you know, different patients are still alive and different and patients have different disease burden, we just might need different kinds of guys to help take care of them. And that's a complete unknown because we don't know much about that other stuff I already talked about. I think there's been a change in public knowledge and perception of related specialties. So I think there's a new awareness of epidemiologists, for Pete's sake. I think most people have heard more about epidemiology in the last 3 months than they have in the previous three decades. Respiration therapy, oh my goodness, so front and center. And all those ventilator stories involve a respiration therapist, and it's really important. And they've gotten a lot of airtime, and I don't think people used to know about that. Emergency room doctors and critical care doctors and other professionals, again, we've been hearing a lot about them, and we call them healthcare heroes all the time. People clap when they go to work and when they come home from work. That we also have with that a new awareness of the risks they have faced in their work, but also the value society seems to put on their work. And again, they've been clapped at when they've been, you know, they get clapped at and get music played to them and all the things. So I don't know how that affects like the entry into those different fields. Balancing that risk and perceived value is just going to be an interesting thing, and it'll just play out in data. I think the physical organization of care facilities and physical and care spaces might change again with awareness on infectious diseases. I've already seen articles about architectural changes to offices and hospitals and outpatient clinics to help reduce the probability that sick people are around each other. And obviously that's a strong reaction to the COVID situation, but back to that infectious disease mitigation, that's probably gonna have other payoffs for other infectious diseases. And I think the final thing, which it sounds tiny, and maybe it is tiny, maybe a lot of these things are tiny, but I think it's worth thinking a little bit about is the training pipeline. Again, I don't know if people look at the same headlines I do, but the MCATs have been in disarray and how whether or not they're going to be required for rising college seniors who want to apply to medical school or people who are already out of college, and some college and there's just been a lot of different guidance about whether to delay the MCATs, whether to let them be in person, whether different medical schools maybe aren't going to require them anymore. I don't know. It's disarray is the word. And so like, does that matter? Does it matter that there's just like a year where no one starts medical school because no one could take the tests? And I just don't know what the implications of that are, but that's playing out throughout the training pipeline. So the rotations that physicians have during medical school are designed on purpose to give them exposure to different aspects of medicine and human bodies and illness and all that thing. That didn't happen normally this last spring. Do you have all of those guys stay in medical school longer to catch that up? Or was that not important? And does that mean we revisit what medical training looks like? Because why did we waste everyone's time if it didn't matter that you didn't get it? I just don't know how to think about that stuff. Further down, people are picking internships. Once they're finished with medical school, they're picking internships. And I think that process was somewhat challenging this spring because it usually involves flying around the country a lot and people weren't doing that. So and the same kind of stories are playing out for nursing, for nurse training and other things. So if you just think about who plays those roles and where do the new ones come from, that's just not happening right now in the normal way. And I don't know what remedies people are thinking about, but I don't know the consequence of that, but I think it's not nothing, but it might not be very huge. Anyway, last slide, I promise. I want to just real quick go back up to this idea that I've been talking about, the system/policy, which I haven't talked about at all, but hopefully it's implied now and in the future. And a couple of things that just knock around in my head when I think about that is who are the people in key non-political policy analysis and administration roles right now and post the next election? A thing that I have seen over the last couple of years, which has been of great concern to me, is the loss of mid and senior level people in the Medicare agency who, for a variety of reasons, haven't stayed. And I think it's consequential, and I don't know how this, a couple of the people who have stayed have been working, I'm not exaggerating, you know, 18 hours a day, 7 days a week for 4 months now, and they're exhausted. So people left and or they stayed and have been working their asses off. And so I just don't know who's in those jobs moving forward. And obviously the outcome of the election might affect that. But even regardless of that, I think it's just, it's a labor force that I care about and see and worry about. I think the thing that's going to happen on the policy front is there's going to be analyses of different state responses versus the federal response. And what are the lessons learned from the different natural experiments of Texas versus Minnesota versus Maine versus New York, whatever. And I think one of the really big factors that's going to matter to how we understand that is the role of Medicaid expansions. Texas didn't take on the Obamacare Medicaid expansion. And so as the virus burden grows there and the unemployment burden grows there, there's a differential effect on access to care because they don't have the Medicaid expansion that whatever 30, whatever other states have. So even as we try to sort of look at the natural experiment at the state level, there's this really important policy decision that was made a few years ago that's likely correlated with the policy decisions that have been made in the last few months. And so it's just going to be a tricky to tease out what's important and what the best practices will be going forward. But I think you'll see a lot of papers and research about that. And obviously I'm going to end with the fact that everything I just told you probably has nothing to do with what's really going to matter, because I think the movement for Black lives and the spotlight it's put on longstanding social justice issues in throughout our country and our systems, coupled with the 2020 elections, I think those two things are just going to have a much bigger, well, they're going to really complicate and inform how these various things that I've just outlined are attended to, both with research, data analysis, and how that information is used to inform policy moving forward. And with that, I will stop. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Katie, for that presentation. Very thoughtful. I think that this is the way that I feel about it. It's just nice that there are professionals like yourself that are looking out for us, in the sense that there are people trying to, you know, get us back to a sense of normalcy. So I thank you for that. Hopefully, once that normalcy comes back, we can have live EHS presentations as well. So now we are going to have a musical interlude. The song that you'll be hearing is Staying Alive by the Bee Gees. Q&A period will follow, and viewers should be thinking about their questions and entering them in the chat box. Contributions will be collected virtually at the following website address, ethicalhumanistsociety.org/donate. You can go to our webpage if you want to find that as well, ethicalhumanistsociety.org. Donations can be accepted with a credit card or PayPal on our site, or using the Zelle app, Zelle, Z-E-L-L-E. It is through our generosity that we show how meaningful the Sunday morning programs are. The suggested donation is $5. However, any amount that one is comfortable with is greatly appreciated. We appreciate all those who help sustain the society with their donations of time and money.
Around since I was born, I have a daughter, and I'm okay, and you may.
Okay, now the chat box is open for questions. Please post your questions there if you do have any. I'll try to get to as many questioners as possible, and I'm sure Katie will be willing to stay during the coffee hour that follows the follows the Q&A session immediately after this to continue the conversation. So first question, great presentation, Katie. We know doctors already deal with higher levels of stress that affects home life. Do you know if anyone is studying the social implications of COVID on healthcare providers?
I don't know. I am not aware of that, but I don't, that doesn't mean anything. Like, this is proof by lack of counterexample, right? And I suspect there's going to be a lot of studies like that. The one thing I am aware of that's somewhat related is, I mentioned earlier that a friend of mine was an emergency room doctor at Northwestern. And his work schedule had been 5 days on, 1 day off. And as I mentioned, his wife, who is my good friend, was quite concerned about him and his well-being because he was really stressed and having bad long days. And there was a sea change when Northwestern, in the middle, like in April, I think, changed to him working 6 days on, 5 days off. And that was pivotal for him and his well-being because that 5 days off, the first 3 days, I think he was just kind of shut down and trying to catch up with himself. But then he had sort of 2 days of just being like a person, and then he'd go back to work for 6 days. So I was impressed with that real time shift. And it makes me hopeful that managers throughout the healthcare system are trying to watch for that and think about that and how to mitigate that. And my hunch is there's going to be differential responses, in different kinds of settings and for different kinds of caregivers, but I am not aware of any kind of a systematic analysis.
Okay, thank you. Next question, any lessons from Europe that are relevant to the issues you addressed?
That's so funny. So that turns out that because the European, I think pretty much all European countries have a really different healthcare system, it's very hard to figure out the policy changes from Europe. That the health, the COVID stuff, the actual disease stuff, yes, to lots of information from Europe. And there's been an extraordinary amount of international cooperation, which I find heartening. But I also, talking to people in Europe who are just like, what is this headline even mean when they see things about patients getting bills after an ambulance ride or something like that? So from a policy perspective, it's super hard to translate in our current system. I think that question about Europe will probably be much more salient to those other issues, the issues of social justice that I think the Movement for Black Lives is raising, and potential future presidents who aren't Donald Trump. Probably we'll learn a lot from Europe with regard to sort of how to maybe reorganize the system. But without that, it's not obvious that there's much we learn at the policy level, possibly some care system input.
Okay. Can you speak to what the cost, billing, and implementation of a vaccine might look like?
So, yes and no. I can probably say nothing helpful, but I'll say a lot of words that may or may not help your thinking about it. Cost, there's two words. Cost has multiple meanings in this conversation. What does it cost to produce a vaccine? Is a very specific question. And it's a challenging one to answer because by the time the drug development stuff has happened, the actual production cost of vaccines can be quite marginal. But all that development work had to happen. So when you're a drug company and you finally get the vaccine, you can't just bill it at a buck because it costs a buck to make it when you spent billions of dollars to develop it. The challenge in the US system is there's a lot of forgiveness for that, the research and development stuff. So actually figuring out what it costs is actually really hard to do, even including the research and development piece of it. So cost in that way is tricky, but you'll see a wide variety of numbers. You'll see numbers from the marginal production cost, which I think is probably unfair, to a cost that includes all the research and development, which is possibly also unfair. you probably mean cost from the perspective of a patient, and that will depend terribly on who the insurers are and what different insurers' policies make. So, and also the patent situation. So, if there's an unpatented, or if the patent is donated to the public domain, then it will just the patients. It will probably be fairly inexpensive. But if it's patented, then different insurers will probably be able to strike different bargains with the patent holder. That's what happens right now in the Medicare drug benefit. The same drug costs very different amounts on different Medicare drug plans because different insurers strike differently good bargains with specific manufacturers. Some plans will make the decision to make it very cheap to patients because the long-term advantage to the health plan is that patients get vaccinated, and they may go ahead and eat the cost of the vaccine because they'll, over the long run, pay out less than other care costs. And some insurers may or may not do that. On the Medicare side, Medicare will likely face huge pressure to make COVID vaccines, if they're appropriate for the elderly. I suspect for Medicare, they'll be quite cheap. But that might not inform what it is for privately insured younger people.
Makes sense. What are your personal thoughts, recommendations regarding the issues you mentioned with the disruptions to clinical rotations for medical trainees?
I got nothing good to say about that. It hurts my heart because I think we need to have people continue their training, and we need to believe that the way they've been using their training time was useful. So it feels surprising to me that you would just sort of shut stuff down for months and then still call them done at the same time. That seems surprising, right? But it also is just a whole nother layer of lives really sort of thrown sideways to say, now you have another year of school that you have to, or half a year, depending on how all this plays out. So I have no insight. I have sympathy for the guys who have to make the decisions and for the students and trainees who are affected by them. And again, there's a natural experiment here. How does this cohort of caregivers, how do we see them 5 years from now and 10 years from now, just in their care, like the quality of the care they give? And that's a really long-term study that probably no one will undertake, but that's almost what you need to do to really understand that. And I suspect it's going to be different. I think it's going to be different in different, clinical areas. And some like the practical nursing is about patient care. Like, you need to touch bodies. You need to be comfortable giving sponge baths. And I don't think you can Zoom that. So I feel like that's just kind of wait, right? As opposed to, I don't know, enough of like pathology. You never really do touch anybody if you're a pathologist, as far as I understand it. And so maybe it's possible for pathologist training to be unperturbed. Although probably the kinds of things that they see, that their familiarity with different diseases will be diminished because they won't be seeing the same array. So my hunch is there's not a one-size-fits-all solution, both in clinical areas and clinical roles. But I have no smart thing to say about that.
Okay. Next question. Do you see the current situation normalizing the implementation of teledoc visits for common ailments within our current healthcare system?
I think that, yes, I do. For a lot of patient populations and for certain things, I think the trick is going to again be the selectivity and specificity of that tool. There, as I mentioned in my talk, there was this idea that it was very much to create access to experts for people who were physically remote. And then a few years ago, you guys, people on this who are watching this may have eventually gotten a thing from their doctor in the last 4 or 5 years that says, if you call, you might get a bill. If you call your doctor, you might get a $10 bill or something like that. And so there was the AMA procedure code list added a phone visit as a service that a physician could write down and bill for. And my own doctor started that process, 8 or 9 years ago. Medicare added as a billable service, a phone call with your doctor a couple of years ago, the payment rate was viewed as laughably low. I want to make up, it was like 10 bucks, but don't quote me on that, even though I was involved in doing it. I just don't remember. But doctors were like, it's like you're not paying for it. It's 8 bucks or 10 bucks or something. And so Medicare had these sort of two paradigms, a phone call that was paid at a very low rate and doctors were unimpressed with that versus this more broader telemedicine enterprise, which included a broader array of care and paid more generously, but under a very limited circumstances. So I think the fact that that's all been smooshed together right now is going to be a huge political issue and it's going to have financial consequences. So I do think it's going to normalize the notion of a phone visit, whatever that might be, for certain kinds of care and for certain patients, but it probably can't be paid as generously in Medicare as it is right now. And so when that happens and when they have to sort of figure out how to pay less, I think we're going to hear from doctors again. The converse is how on earth can it make sense to pay the same as when the patient comes and is seen by your nurse to get roomed and all the vitals taken and all that stuff. Anecdotally, the other side on the Medicare side, the other thing that's interesting to me about this question about telehealth and televisits is that there used to be a lot of literature about the elderly, socially isolated elderly using healthcare as a social engagement. And so another piece of the telehealth thing for the Medicare population, not necessarily for the working age population, is just social isolation when seeing a doctor has been kind of a highlight of some people's lives. And some people go more often than they need to because the doctor will talk to them. And I don't know if telehealth, how that fits into that and the potential emotional and psychological effects of patients who have sought out the physical engagement with their doctor. I saw one headline that was like, if I don't go to my doctor, I may not literally physically touch another human being or be touched by a human being. And it's like, that's a very sobering thought. So.
It's very sad. What is your view of the delay in testing early in the pandemic that appear to be caused by CDC's reluctance to allow different states to use non-CDC authorized test kits?
You know, that's the kind of stuff when I was talking about Bedlam, that's kind of stuff I was talking about. I'm not knowledgeable enough at all about the importance and the quality differences and the supply chains for those different resources. I am very aware of the challenge that the differences, different standards and different definitions really pose challenges for our ability to learn from the experiments that we've been undergoing. So I think broadly, my take on that, and there's a bunch of similar examples, the lack of a clear guidance from the federal government has really been problematic in a billion ways. And it's material, it's the actual material, the actual test kits and how to use them well and how to allocate them. I talked about the nursing home thing and we were tasked with how do we put the surveillance on the right places since we can't be everywhere. I'm kind of shocked that there wasn't that kind of thinking about all these other kinds of resources. So I think the lack of national planning and messaging is really consequential, but I don't have a particular insight into that specific question.
Okay, we probably have time for one or two more questions. So if you can, please post your questions in the comment section. Next question, let's see which one it was. Do you see bureaucratic barriers to greater testing or is it largely cost limitations? In other words, why are we not massively testing folks who are not symptomatic?
I really don't know. I think that's a failure. Again, I'm back to the national thing and the messaging. And I, to be honest, my own very, literally non-expert, but I make up stuff anyway, is that I think local and state leaders were left scrambling in lots of ways that they didn't expect to be. And they just weren't ready to take those decisions on. And the fact that they're being made at local and state levels is really problematic because those are places that aren't staffed up to be doing this. There really was like federal resources in the form of expertise and data and contracting capacities and things like that that weren't exploited. And I think that's consequential in a million ways. But one of them is that it trickles down to people having to fill those roles without those resources, without that knowledge and without the expertise and with no clear guidance from somebody who does that expertise. So I think that's I don't have any specific answer to that either, but I do think it's not surprising given the lack of any consistent and help and support from the federal government.
Okay. Next question. I just learned that Advocate Aurora cut provider pay by 20% during all of this. Do you know if other healthcare systems are doing the same, and how do you see this impacting the supply side in the future? In other words, will this lead to providers leaving the profession and or discouraging people from entering it?
You know, that's a great question. I have not seen any consistent summary of that. I've seen headlines like that in different places. The magnitude's different. And those are managers that are so real quick, someplace like Advocate Aurora, I don't know the case particularly, but a lot of healthcare systems shut down all that elective care in March, April, May that I was talking about. They didn't get any money. Like the one hospital on the North Shore of Chicago, which is predominantly elective care and unlikely to be seeing people naturally coming in with COVID, was basically empty for the month of April. And the physicians there didn't have much to do, and the other caregivers just didn't have much to do. That place didn't generate any revenue that month. And so it's just like the restaurants that don't have patients. I mean, it's just a business problem at some point. It absolutely might affect the supply side. And that's one of the, when I said burnout, I didn't call it out, but that was one of the things that I have in the back of my head, that a lot of places did cut pay because they were seeing compromised revenue streams. They shouldn't have money. So I think that definitely could affect supply. And I also think it will likely lead to earlier retirement. So I think we're going to see, I suspect we will see early retirement for a bunch of current physicians and nurses and whatever. So we're going to lose a lot of expertise kind of quickly, I think, in the next couple of years, which will be too bad.
Okay. Thanks so much for answering all those questions. I'll read some announcements for upcoming society events that will be shared on screen. We encourage viewers to join us via Zoom for the virtual coffee hour. The link information will be provided in the announcements and on the screen. So we'll start with, okay. And here's information for the virtual coffee hour. So following the program today, we'll have a virtual coffee hour. Bring your own coffee or snacks and join us for an open Zoom chat. Click on the link in the comment section or go to ethicalhumanistsociety.org/July26th. Coffee hour. Also, our Sunday school will continue to meet through the rest of the summer. If you'd like to join in for virtual games, crafts, and more, contact Sharon Applequist at sundayschool@ethicalhuman.org. New families are welcome. Thanks to everyone who participated in our food and toiletries drive yesterday in our parking lot. The next collection will be on Saturday, August 22nd from 12:30 to 2 p.m. Volunteers will be in our parking lot to accept contactless donations of non-perishable food items and toiletries for the Hillside Food Pantry in Evanston and the Niles Township Food Pantry in Skokie. For more information and a full list of accepted items, go to ethicalhumanistsociety.org/food drive or send an email to act@ethicalhuman.org. All EHS members are invited to a call to action meeting on Sunday, August 2nd at 9:30 a.m. We'll share plans and ideas for keeping our community invigorated during this pandemic. Watch the email for further details later this week. Our next live stream event will be on Sunday, August 9th at 10:30 a.m. Svetlana Beckman, Senior Counsel at Northern Trust, will present Getting Your Affairs in Order, Estate Planning Essentials. People are feeling vulnerable and fearful in the midst of the pandemic. We can harness these emotions to take evidence-based steps to minimize risk. We can also write down our wishes for when we can't speak for ourselves. Svetlana will walk us through the basics of estate planning, including powers of attorney for property and healthcare, wills and trusts. The ultimate goal is to help our loved ones take care of us and our finances when we can no longer do so. For more details on these or any of our other activities, see our website at ethicalhumanistsociety.org, connect with us on Facebook and Twitter, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for videos of past speakers and future streaming programs. Okay, so I'll end the talk with some closing words. Is a brief quote. Now is a time, if ever there was one, for us to care selflessly about one another. And that is from Dr. Anthony Fauci, Director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. Thanks everyone for coming, and thanks again, Katie, for a wonderful presentation. I'm gonna invite everyone to join us in our virtual coffee hour, which is immediately following this presentation. Thanks everyone for coming.